إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا إن النفس لأمارة بالسوء ومن سيئات أعمالنا من جاء بالحسنة فله عشر أضعافها ومن جاء بالسيئة فلا يجزى إلا مثلها وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله خلق فسوى وقدر فهدى ربنا ورب آبائنا الأولى وأشهد أن سيدنا وهادينا وإمامنا والمعصوم فينا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله والذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين وآخرين منهم لما يلحقوا بهم وهو العزيز الحكيم ذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم أما بعد committed Muslims, brothers and sisters. For those of you who are conscious of the Islamic calendar, this is the month of Al-Muharram, which is one of the four sanctity or sacred or secure months of the year. Inna iddata ash-shuhuri 'inda Allahi 12 shahra fi kitabillah yawma khalaqa as-samawati wal-ard minha arba'atun hurum. For those of you who are more conscious of the Islamic past or Islamic history, it was during this month a shahr haram, it was during this month that an Islamic or what is called an Islamic dynasty, dynastic rulers, were responsible for what has come down to us in our references as the tragedy or the massacre of Karbala on the day of Ashura, the 10th day of the month of Al-Muharram, which is the first month of the Islamic calendar. You and I, or many of us, are aware that this incident is observed every year with, by some Muslims, not by all Muslims, with an outpour of emotions. And emotional it is when it is considered in light of its details. It was a tragedy. It was a force of 70-odd committed Muslims clashing with another force of thousands of Muslims. We are not here, and I've said this before, and I will repeat myself, because repetition on this occasion seems like it's not enough. There's been a subculture that has built in and around this occasion that has almost put it off limits to our rational consideration of what happened on that occasion. We need to take a more measured and a more analytical approach to what happened on that day. Let me, before I begin some thoughts about this, relying on the Book of Allah and the guidance of His Prophet, before I begin that, let me clear the air and acknowledge that there are some hadith that in effect say that the 10th of Al-Muharram is a day that should be observed by Muslims because it is the day when the followers of Musa were rescued from the tyranny of the Pharaoh. And thus, Muslims should be thankful on this day, and Muslims should also fast on this day, or the 10th of Al-Muharram. Let me say that there are hadith that have to be filtered out of hadith literature. And these hadith, there's a few of them, that want the Muslims to think or to believe that the 10th of Muharram is the occasion that dates back to Musa rather than the occasion that is synonymous with Imam al-Husayn. Let me say that these hadiths are the fabrication of the enemies of Imam al-Husayn, in as far as the dynastic regimes that ruled, beginning with Muawiyah and thereon. They pumped these types of hadiths to eclipse the occasion and the meanings of Ashura or Karbala. Let me also add that there is no other hadith or no other ayah that I know of that tells us to honor a particular occasion in the history of Bani Israel. There are many ayat and there are many hadiths that pertain to Bani Israel. Almost one third of the Quran itself relates to the adverse and the cantankerous history of Bani Israel. But none of them, once again, as far as I am aware, none of them instruct us to observe a particular detail of that history. So here we find a hadith or hadiths that cannot fit into the context of the Quran. And when that happens, we are better off sidelining those types of hadiths. And this opens up a broader issue of the filtration of the body of hadith from alien hadiths that are in it. And now is not the time for that. We go back to this event in which we have Muslims fighting Muslims. This is a hard thing to swallow, but it is a fact of life. And we still have these types of occurrences in our societies. Look around today at the world and what is happening in it, our world, and we will see that Muslims are fighting Muslims. And as we mentioned previously, and we will echo that idea here, Allah Jalla wa Ala teaches us that it is not impossible that Muslims come to blow with Muslims. The ayah in Surah Al-Hujurat, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُ بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِن بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. If it was impossible for Muslims to face off at the battlefield, we wouldn't have had this ayah. But Allah has created us and our human nature, and He knows how we will interact with each other. So in this occasion, we have Muslims who are facing off with Muslims, which I think, as a humble brother of yours, I think this should open up our minds pertaining to two very important issues that have to be addressed by our thinking ability, our God-given endowment of being able to think and reason. The first one is the issue of legitimacy. Do we have, as Muslims in the world, or have we had in our history, in the past, rulers who were illegitimate? Before we are overwhelmed by the emotional component of this occasion, we should ask ourselves, do we have illegitimate power structures that rule over us? This has to be answered. Before we step one step forward, we have to answer this question. Do we have rulers and governments and administrations that are legitimate, or do we have them as illegitimate? And when we define legitimacy, we don't do that by going to an encyclopedia somewhere or to a particular political scientist or ideologue. We refer ourselves to Allah and His Prophet. They are the ones who will define for us who is a legitimate ruler, what is a legitimate governance, and what is not. This occasion of Ashura has been with the Muslims for around 14 centuries. And still, every year, the Muslims who are observant of this occasion, they still don't communicate to the rest of the people, Muslims or non-Muslims, that people can have legitimate authorities and they can have illegitimate authorities. Because, brothers and sisters, I feel constrained, but I have to say it. This issue, as much as it on this day and tomorrow and this, as much as you will hear from speakers and from preachers and from khatibs and from etc., as much as you will hear the word Imam al-Hussein and Yazid, you'll hear that plentifully. But this is not an issue of personalities per se. This is an issue of methodologies. This is an issue of orientation. This is an issue of principle. Why can't we concentrate on this area so that we can raise the smoke and the fog out of this occasion? So everyone who knows about it, regardless of their backgrounds, whether it is religious or political, whether it is national or ethnic, regardless of who they are, you present them with these facts and they can resonate with these facts. The first question that should come to anyone's mind, provided our minds are present on this occasion and our minds can trump our emotions, the first question is, was the dynasty or the regime or the ruling family of Yazid, was it legitimate or was it not legitimate? The air has to be cleared on this subject. And emotions are not going to clear, emotions by themselves are not going to clear the air. Yazid, as well as his father Muawiyah, have to be defined by the facts surrounding them. There were wars. Ashura and Karbala did not just happen in thin air. There was a background and a backdrop to it. When Muawiyah was at war with Imam Ali, there are many, but this is not the time for the many, just to cite one expose of the nature of legitimacy versus illegitimacy. The legitimacy of Imam Ali versus the illegitimacy of Muawiyah. Thereafter, King Muawiyah. One indicator that we Muslims never think through our history is we call Muawiyah a Khalifa. He's a king. But this once again indicates that we never think through whatever we were involved in. Whichever side you happen to be on, this is a fact of life. The Prophet of Allah had said, and this was a hadith that is acknowledged by friend and foe. He said to Ammar ibn Yasir, تَقْتُلُكَ الْفِئَةُ الْبَاغِيَةِ. The aggressive faction is going to kill you. When this war at Siffin occurred, Ammar ibn Yasir was killed by the camp of Muawiyah. So the Prophet's hadith right now became self-explanatory. Now we know who al-fi'a al-baghiya is. The aggressive faction or side is taqtuluka al-fi'atu al-baghiya. Now we go back to the ayah in which the same word is used. وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Okay, if two sides of Muslims find themselves at blows at the battlefield, then Allah tells the rest of us that we should reconcile these two sides. That's the first thing that should be done. But if one side refuses to reconcile, then the war effort should be directed against that side. فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. So the Prophet of Allah said in one of these statements that will foretell future events that you, Ammar, are going to be killed by al-fi'a al-baghiya. This faction of Muawiyah killed Ammar, so it incurred the Prophet's description, al-fi'a al-baghiya. Now, our question is, at this point, without pulling in other information, question is this fi'a baghiya legitimate? Can it have the legitimacy that comes to it from the Book of Allah and from the Sunnah of His Prophet? It cannot. Let's be clear on this. There shouldn't be any question marks and exclamation marks and all these other... No, it's clear. There is no legitimacy. Now, if we have a ruler who is not legitimate, the second question is, we said there are two issues that have to be cleared. The first one is the issue of legitimacy, this or illegitimacy, and the second one is the issue of opposition. How are we to oppose illegitimate rulers or illegitimate rule? Opposition is at different levels. You can have a verbal opposition. You can have a media opposition. You can have a popular opposition. And then you can have armed opposition. The question that we have to clarify, I'm sorry to say, after 1,400 years among ourselves, we haven't clarified this question. And that is, when do we carry arms to oppose illegitimate authority? Here is where we bring ourselves to Imam al-Husayn. this Yazid, knowing that he's illegitimate, he knows he's illegitimate. First of all, there is no inheritance of power in Islam. You can't, just because you're born into a certain family, your father was a king, then you as a son become a king. This is not, there's no basis for this in the Quran or in the Sunnah. But this is exactly what had happened in this case. We had a son who became the king of the Muslims. Not a Khalifa. Throw that word out. So, in his attempt to secure that legitimacy, he told, this Yazid was in Damascus, he told his governors in Arabia, particularly the ones in Hijaz, in Mecca and in Al-Madinah, he told them to secure the bay'ah of three individuals, thereby, in Yazid's mind, he will have secured his public legitimacy. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Umar, and Imam al-Husayn ibn Ali. These are the ones that he wanted to come out in public and endorse his rule. And history had its details of Islamic opposition to the Umayyad feudalistic dynasty. But in as far as Imam al-Husayn, he wasn't willing and he wasn't going to express a bay'ah to an illegitimate ruler. At this point, Imam al-Husayn wasn't carrying any arms. See, brothers and sisters, let's take this step by step. Imam al-Husayn is the grandson of Allah's Prophet. We don't say this with any asabiyyah in it. We say this because of the virtues and the good influence that was generated in the house of the Prophet, or the household of the Prophet, by the Prophet himself. The Prophet of Allah, who is everyone's point of reference. The Prophet of Allah stayed 13 years in Mecca, and the word armed opposition did not appear in his statements or in a tanzeel. There was no such thing as armed opposition. To put it in today's language, the Prophet was going about his own business, communicating to people the message of Allah, the message of Islam. But in the nature, the way power structures work, they can't tolerate a person that they think is subversive. So they looked at Muhammad ibn Abdullah as a subversive. Therefore, he's not going to be given his full civic character with the rights and the freedoms that belong to it. So they eventually, after 13 years, turned antagonistic. Not in any sense of the word, they turned antagonistic to the extent that they wanted to kill him. Notice, brothers and sisters here, who wants to kill whom? Wasn't the Prophet of Allah, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon him and his, it wasn't he who wanted to kill anyone. It were these people who were in power who wanted to kill him. So what do you do here when people who have militaries, who have the materialistic and the financial wherewithal, when they turn against you now, you've become their target. You are wanted dead or alive. What is to be done here? When we take a look at the ayat in the Quran, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the mushrik society of Mecca turned militaristically antagonistic towards Allah's Prophet and those who were with him, Allah gave them permission to defend themselves. This was the first time we hear about an opposition that can be called armed resistance. The ayah says, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. Permission from on high, from Allah Azza wa Jal. Permission has been granted to those who have been oppressed, those who have been offended, those who have been aggressed upon. أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا. Permission has been given to those whom war has been waged against them due to policies and procedures and strategies and politics of oppression and injustice. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. And indeed, Allah is capable of giving them victory and triumph. When the Prophet of Allah had to, by force, it wasn't out of his own initiative. It was, the fact of the matter is, he was forced to leave Mecca under the threat of arms, the mushrik's arms, and the mushrik's intention to kill him and finish him off. What do you do when the same character of the mushriks of Mecca, the same character, resurfaces now concerning Al-Imam Al-Husayn? They look at him, they perceive him as a subversive, an insurgent, an outlaw. That's the official perception of this one individual. Because he refused to endorse a power structure that is illegitimate. In the character of his grandfather, oppression now, injustice, he has been dealt. What does he do? He goes and he thinks about, let me try to think about a plan of my own. Or he listens to what Allah and the Prophet say in circumstances and conditions like this. So when war was imposed upon him, he countered that war with a war in his own means. This is where we find a person who stands on principle. During that time, look, some people came up to him with good intentions and with their best advice. And they said, why don't you go to Al-Yemen? There you have a support base and the terrain there will help against what is being planned against you. He didn't do it. He could have done that. It was a choice. He didn't do that. Mecca is supposed to be the refuge. We know this from the inception of Mecca, from the Abrahamic history, from its Abrahamic roots, that Mecca is a place where mustad'afs or homeless people go. Prophet Ibrahim didn't have a people of his own. He didn't have a country of his own. Mecca became his place of residence. When this type of Mecca now, due to the political developments of that time, this type of Mecca could no longer tolerate persons who it was meant for, Imam al-Hussein had to leave. And this is another area that has to be the attraction of our thoughts. The people of southern Iraq, al-Kufa, they, in the best possible wording, they pledged that they would support an Imam al-Hussein. We know from what happened thereafter that they abandoned that pledge. This is another area that Muslims have to think about carefully. What do you do when you have thousands of people who say they support you? But when the forces show up, when the Umayyad regime with its military force, Ibn Ziyad, on behalf of Yazid, when they show up with their might, you look around, where's everyone? What happened? You were the ones who were saying you were going to be supportive. But all of a sudden, that support evaporated. What happened? Should not this serve as a lesson for leaders, or potential leaders, or organizers who say that they have such and such support? Can they take that for granted? Did anyone learn from this? Still, when they abdicated their written responsibilities, Imam al-Hussein stood on principle. What do you do? He could have, at the last moment, in those final days, knowing what was about to occur, he could have easily stepped out of that whole thing and said, you know, the balance of forces here are tremendously against my position, so this is going to need more time, and it's going to need more education, and it's going to need more of the stuff that many people say today. The issue here is, what happened to principle? Another issue is the issue of death itself. Some people think that when they are brought into the vicinity of death, they begin to feel that death is going to occur in a day or two. Then they also find that this is something that they can't take anymore. What's wrong? We're all going to die. When we Muslims, when we repeat the fact of death in our salah every day, then when it is about to happen, we don't want to be around? What type of commitment are we speaking about? And this is what we are saying about the commitment of the people in that time and the commitment of the people in our time. The ayah says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمْ وأنتم لا تعلمون. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. أدعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة، وتوبوا إلى الله غافر الذنب وقابل التوب شديد العقاب وإليه المصير. الحمد لله الذي هدى، صلى الله وسلم على سيدنا المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه أولي النهى والتقى. Dear committed brothers and sisters on the course to Allah, the years that we are speaking about, this was around the 5th, the 6th, and the 7th decade after the Hijrah. The years that we are speaking about were sent down to us via the channels of those who wrote this history. And the conquerors always write mainstream history. This is equally true in the world at large as it is true in our peculiar history. The conquerors are the ones who wrote this history. They didn't write it in history books. They wrote it by attributing hadiths to the Prophet and by having court scholars who would register events from the point of view of those who were in power. And we have inherited all of this. And it's become a scary discovery. If Muslims were to trace the injustice of today to the injustice of those times, the monarchies that exist today are the offspring of the monarchies that existed in that time. Yesterday, or the day before, the Mufti of Saudi Arabia, a person who is almost at a rank of minister, comes out and he says that these people, there are people around who are criticizing or assailing or verbally attacking the Saudi king. This Mufti calls him Wali al-Amr. And he says, and I'm putting these in my own words, but the general meaning is that these people who are doing this are sick minds, facet individuals, and are tantamount to the enemies of Islam. We don't know where this person lodges his logic in. We don't know where that comes from. The Book of Allah exposes the Pharaoh. And the Pharaoh is the description of a person who has tremendous power and uses that power to contravene Allah and His Prophet. When someone speaks about a person in a public position, a decision maker, a king or a president. He's not speaking about his personal life. There's nothing to do with his personal life, although we know that it is polluted with sin and with transgressions. We know that. We're not concerned with his personal life. When this person makes Mecca and Medina off limits to all of the Muslims of the world, when Gaza is being attacked and may be attacked in the coming months and in the coming years, and we cannot, we as Muslims, we cannot put our thoughts together, we cannot put our hearts together in Mecca, why can't we do that? Someone's responsible. An ayah in the Quran says, وَلِتَسْتَبِيلَ سَبِيلُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ, so that the course of criminals may become explicit and clear. Who are these criminals? Unknowns? Crimes against humanity. War crimes. And the list goes on. All of these happen as an act of nature. Or there are people who are responsible for these acts. The information that comes to us from Allah and His Prophet tells us that we should not identify criminals. Or we should identify them. And when we identify them, should we expose the fact that they are legitimate or illegitimate? They abuse power? They have a thriving prison population? There are no civil rights, no civic rights, no natural rights, no political rights, no rights at all in some of these countries? A person becomes a ruler because he's born in a certain family. And his son and grandson become emirs and princes because they were born in that family. Where is the justification, the explanation, the legitimacy for this? From the Book of Allah or from the statements of His Prophet? We ask. And if we ask these questions, we are mufsideen fil ard, we are fasideen, we are sick in our minds and in our hearts, as this mufti is saying, because we are attempting to define and to categorize what Allah and His Prophet are telling us. Oh Allah, we seek refuge from people like this, who have made it possible for all of these years for this tyranny and this despotism to continue in our midst. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna tiba'a wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna jtinaba wa la taj'alhu multabisan alayna waj'alna lil-muttaqina imama. اللهم إليك نشكو ضعف قوتنا وقلة حيلتنا وهوانا على الناس يا أرحم الراحمين أنت ربنا وأنت رب المستضعفين فإلى من تكلنا إلى غريب يتجهمنا أم إلى عدو ملكته أمرنا إن لم يكن بك علينا غضب فلا نبالي ولكن عافيتك هي أوسع لنا نعوذ بنور وجهك الذي أشرقت له الظلمات وصلح عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة من أن تنزل بنا غضبك أو تحل علينا سخطك لك العتبى حتى ترضى ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم بارك على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم اللهم بارك على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها، أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين، لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها، وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل، إن الله نعم ما يعظكم به، إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة ثم على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة.